Welcome to our first fully online worship service. I want to say a thank you to Rick Bean for our prelude music and to all those who helped put this service together today, and to you who are joining us live on Facebook or perhaps watching later on YouTube. For those who are participating on Facebook in the watch party, we would invite you to comment and chat away. Because we pre-recorded the service, I will be there to help host and interact at both the 9 o'clock and the 11 o'clock viewing of the service. And I'm thrilled that we can do that together and have some interaction. Other folks may be watching later on YouTube or on our website, and we hope that you're able to do that as well. This is our first time doing this, so we're still working out some things. And that includes what to use in the service and what to modify. We want to adapt to this new format, but we also want to preserve some of what makes Good Shepherd worship unique and special. So sometimes in the service, you may see us use a clip that someone has sent in to participate. And other times, you may see me here in the sanctuary in what I hope will be a familiar setting, even though we aren't able to be here in person. And I know, finally, for many, worshiping online will be different. But I would invite you to turn off any side tabs or screens or your phones or the television and to enter into worship together with us for the next 30 minutes or so. Be still for a moment and know that God is with us. So let us prepare our hearts and minds for worship now as Marlis Littleton reads the call to worship from Psalm 105.
The call to worship is from Psalm 105, 1-5. Oh, give thanks to the Lord. Call upon his name. Make known his deeds among the peoples. Sing to him. Sing praises to him. Speak of all his wonders. Glory in his holy name. Let the heart of those who seek the Lord be glad. Seek the Lord and his strength. Seek his face continually. Remember his wonders which he has done, his marvels and judgments uttered by his mouth. Come, let us worship the Lord.
Well, let's worship together in song. From the comforts of our own living room, let's sing "Oh for a Thousand Tongues" and "Build My Life." Those two songs together, let's sing.
Oh, for a thousand tongues to sing my great Redeemer's praise, the glories of my God and King, the triumphs of his grace. My gracious master and my God, assist me to proclaim, to spread through all the earth abroad the honors of thy name. Jesus, the name that charms our fears, that bids our sorrow cease. 'Tis music in the sinner's ears, 'tis life and health and peace. Glory to God and praise and love be ever, ever given by saints below and saints above. worthy of every song we could ever sing. Worthy of all the praise we could ever bring. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you. Jesus, the name above every other name. Jesus, the only one who could ever save. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you.
Lord, those are pretty tough words right now. To put our trust in you alone, that we will not be shaken. But Lord, remind us that Jesus Christ is our rock. He's our firm foundation. And that when we yield our lives to him and we let go, that he guides, that he directs, he fills, he leads us. That we might be people who praise him. Not only with our words, but in our actions. With our those around us, our colleagues, and our neighbors. Teach us to be your people in these uncertain times. We pray in your Son's name. Amen.
I would invite you to enjoy passing the peace now and encourage you to say, and also with you, when you hear someone say, "The peace of Christ be with you."
Hello, Good Shepherd friends from the Lampsons. We both hope you're all doing fine and able to get the supplies that you need. We're thinking of you and praying for calm and kindness out there.
May the peace of Christ be with you.
And also with you.
Very funny.
Hello, fellow Good Shepherdarians. We hope you're all staying safe and healthy during this time. Put the soap away. Please excuse that rude interruption. We'd like to tell you that all of our flock is doing very well. They're all safe and healthy. Live from the Pierce House, may the peace of Christ be with you!
We hope to do this each week. So if you or your family would like to help pass the peace in the coming weeks, please let me know and I'll tell you what we need for the video. Now we are going to hear God's word together with the reading of Scripture, a special message for children, and a short message from me.
The first Scripture reading is from Isaiah 12, 1 through 6. Listen, this is the word of the Lord. Then you will say on that day, "I will give thanks to you, O Lord, and although you are angry with me, your anger has turned away, and you comfort me. Behold, God is my salvation, and I will trust you and not be afraid. For the Lord God is my strength and song, and he has become my salvation. Therefore, you will joyously draw water from the springs of salvation. And in that day you will say, 'Give thanks to the Lord. Call on his name. Make known his deeds among the people. Make them remember that his name is exalted. Praise the Lord in song, for he has done excellent things. Let this be known throughout the earth. Cry aloud and shout for joy, O inhabitants of Zion, for great in your midst is the Holy One of Israel.'" This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Good morning, everyone. Children are very important to us and to God. If I can have all the children come to the front of their screen and join me today. This is a strange time right now, isn't it? School is at home. Grocery store shelves are empty. Stores are closed, and church is online today. But don't worry, it's okay to be afraid. Even adults are afraid sometimes. And when I'm scared, I like to ask this question: where is God? What is he doing during all of this? I always try to find God when I'm afraid, because I know that he will protect me. Well, let's turn to God's word to see what he has to say. We're going to read from Romans chapter 8, verse 28. And here's what it says. "And we know that God causes all things to work together for good to those who love God." This verse tells us that God is always working towards what is best for us. That he uses every little detail in our lives to bring goodness and love to our world. And we can trust him even in the midst of this scary virus. And I want to challenge you today to look for the goodness that God is bringing to our worlds in the midst of these circumstances. Just like how God has brought our families closer together. We know that God loves us very much and is always taking care of us. Would you pray with me? Dear God, thank you for your love and your protection. Help us to trust you even when we are scared. Give us eyes to see the good things that you are doing in the world right now. We love you. Amen.
Listen, this is the Word of God. From Luke 17, 11 through 21. While he was on the way to Jerusalem, Jesus was passing between Samaria and Galilee. As he entered a village, 10 leprous men who stood at a distance met him. And they raised their voices, saying, "Jesus, Master, have mercy on us." When he saw them, he said to them, "Go and show yourselves to the priests." And as they were going, they were cleansed. Now one of them, when he saw that he had been healed, turned back, glorifying God with a loud voice. And he fell on his face at Jesus' feet, giving thanks to him. And he was a Samaritan. Then Jesus answered and said, "Were there not 10 cleansed? But the 9, where are they? Was no one found who returned to give glory to God except this foreigner?" And he said to him, "Stand up and go. Your faith has made you well." Now, having been questioned by the Pharisees as to when the kingdom of God was coming, Jesus answered them and said, "The kingdom of God is not coming with signs to be observed, nor will people say, 'Look, here it is,' or 'There it is.' For behold, the kingdom of God is in your midst." This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you that you are with us. Even separated physically, we thank you that your Holy Spirit is uniting us as we gather around your word. Would you speak to us now, words of life and words of hope? We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, you may know the story. Simply said, there were 10 men who were sick. Jesus healed them, and only one came back to say thank you. We typically hear or tell that story as an example of the importance of giving thanks or saying thank you. But there is a lot more going on in the story. Today, I want to tell you the story, and it is a story that has to do with giving God glory. And I want to talk about how thanks leads us into worship of God and helps us turn again and again, even today, to the worship of God. So there were 10 men. There's more to say about them. They had leprosy, which was a horrible disease. There's still some examples of it in the world, but it's nearly eliminated. Jesus was traveling between Galilee and Samaria, and these men approached him, though they maintained a different distance. That's what they're supposed to do. But they called out and they said, "Have mercy on us." And Jesus did have mercy. Now, he didn't heal them right away. This is very interesting. He told them to go show themselves to the priest, because that's what you had to do to be declared healed or cleansed of this terrible disease that ate away at you. And along the way, one of the men realized he had already been healed, and he turned back and went back to Jesus. And he didn't just say thank you and have a good day. He threw himself on the ground, bowed down low, and worshiped, said thank you. And Jesus named it as worship, that he was giving glory to God. What you have there is a miracle attached to faith, but not just faith, kind of blind trust, but a faith that was willing to act on something Jesus had said. Go show yourself to the priest. And in that act of participating in what God was doing, what Jesus had told him to do, the man experienced healing. That's the story. Oh, and the last part is that it involved Samaritans, and particularly the man who turned back was a Samaritan. He wasn't a Jew. He wasn't a part of God's chosen at the time. And really, that's the big point of this story, that God was at work and is at work beyond the walls of the church, the walls, the borders of his people. That's the story here. But today we're going to focus on the worship of God inherent in this man's return. So if that's the story, what about the glory? Glory is how the Bible talks about two aspects of God. Both God's goodness, that is what God has done and is doing, and God's greatness, that is who God is, God's character, God's nature. Both the other readings you heard today, the call to worship from Psalm 105 and the first scripture reading from Isaiah 12, they described God's glory, both of those aspects, what God has done, his goodness, and who God is, his greatness. So what I want to invite you to do is to give God glory in your life. And we're going to see specifically how being thankful and expressing thanks can do that. In the story, the man gave Jesus and God thanks for what he did, healing him, but he also declared God's greatness, and Jesus named it as that. So I offer you an acronym. It spells out the word thanks, T-H-A-N-K-S, and each letter reminds us of a way that we can give God glory and remember God and celebrate God for what he's done and for who he is. So the T in thanks is to remember to say thank you to God. Only one of the ten came back. In verse 16, it says the man thanked Jesus. A first step of worshiping God, of turning to God, is to be thankful, both for what God has done and for who God is. The H in thanks is for humility. The man didn't just offer a casual thanks. He threw himself at Jesus' feet. He bowed down low. It was itself an act of worship, but it was one grounded in realizing how great God is and how small we are. The A in thanks is for adoration. He praised God with a loud voice. He gave praise in the story. He clearly acknowledged that God had healed him, that God had met him on the road, and Jesus commended him for that. When we pray, we should thanks. We should thank God. We should be humble. We should adore God. The N in thanks is for not without faith. I had to be a little creative there. Not without faith. Jesus said to the man, your faith has made you well. Right? Now, it wasn't, again, kind of a believe anything, suspend belief kind of faith. It was specifically that he had participated in the instructions Jesus gave him. Jesus said, go and show yourself to the priest. And so the man went to show himself to the priest. He believed. It was trusting obedience. That's a great definition for faith. The K in thanks is recognition that God's kingdom is in our midst. At the very end of the story, Jesus, speaking to Pharisees, reminded them of that. And this story itself, the healing story, was a great example of that. Right, that God had not just come to the Jews, not just in Jerusalem, not just in the temple made with human hands, not just in a church building, and aren't we glad to hear that news, but that God is at work, God's kingdom is among us, in our midst, even in our own homes, in our basements, in our living rooms, in our cars. God is all over the earth and meets us and is working his purpose out. Finally, the S in thanks is to set aside time for God. I mean, if you can imagine, the man was going to show himself to the priest, and we assume he went on and did that because that was necessary. But he recognized the importance of saying thank you, of glorifying God, of worshiping God. He set aside what he was doing, which was the main thing at that moment. He turned around and went back to Jesus. Right now, you are setting aside time to listen to God's word, to worship together, to connect with other parts of God's family, and to respond in faith. So thanks. Thank you in humility, with adoration, not without faith, recognizing God's kingdom in our midst, setting aside time for God. I want to remind you that right now is the time to turn to God again and again in worship. Not to do that to shut out what's going on in the world, but to turn to God in trusting obedience for the sake of the world, because God's heart, God's hand, God's purpose is all out among this world that we live in. That's the story of Scripture, that God created the world and loved it and has come after it. So when we worship, it's not to huddle away, but it's to come into God's presence and follow Him out into the world. Now clearly that looks different here for a few months where we have to socially distance and all that. But what a great reminder as we have to gather outside the walls of the church that that's where God's heart is. What an opportunity to be the church and be reminded of God's heart for the world. Hope that is an encouragement and a challenge to you this week. May God give us ears to hear and hearts to respond. Amen. 1 John 1:8 tells us, if we say we have no sin, we are deceiving ourselves, and the truth is not in us. Therefore, let us confess. Lord, we confess that we often fail to thank you. Even when we do remember to give thanks, it can be more about us than about you. Help us see your glory with grateful hearts. Let's have a time for silent confession. We ask in Jesus' name. Amen. Rejoice and hear the good news. In Christ we have the redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of sins, according to the riches of God's grace. Thank God for his mercy and grace. It is part of our worship to have a time of responding to God's word with tithes and offerings. For this online format, I'm hoping each week we can share a brief clip from one of our missionaries or perhaps from one of you expressing that response to God's calling and God's word. Today we're going to hear from Karen Cadabaugh, who is on staff with InterVarsity Christian Fellowship at Coastal Carolina. And as you might be able to imagine, this is a challenging time to do college ministry when every school has gone to online or sent students home. So Karen is going to greet us and share some ways we can be praying for her and that ministry.
Hey, Good Shepherd. My name is Karen Cadabaugh. I work for InterVarsity Christian Fellowship at Coastal Carolina University and Ori Georgetown Technical College in Myrtle Beach, South Carolina. Pastor Robert asked me to update y'all on what college ministry looks like in the midst of a pandemic. It's different. Right now, we are brainstorming lots of different ways to do virtual ministry. All my students have been sent home for the time being. Most of them live in South Carolina, but quite a few are scattered throughout the country. So we are going to be practicing some, like I said, some virtual ministry. We're going to be doing virtual Bible studies through Google Docs, and we're going to have some watch parties where we're all going to get together and watch the same thing on Netflix at the same time. We're going to do some online game rooms where we're going to bring people in and they can play games on their phone that'll connect to the whole group. But you can be praying for us right now. There are a lot of students experiencing some fear and anxiety, as I'm sure we're all feeling right now. It's an unknown time in our world, and that can be really scary. So for my students who are not as close with Jesus yet, we are praying that this will be a time that Jesus will draw them closer to himself. And also just praying for my students and faculty and staff who are now experiencing school online with not a lot of heads up. And so there's a lot of confusion, a lot of frustration in trying to do online school for the first time. So be praying that everyone would have grace and patience with each other. But I'm excited. I believe that the Lord can do great things in the midst of unexpected circumstances. And so I trust that we will see God in this season and that this is not just a wasted semester. So prayers for optimism for me and for continued creative energy. And yeah, thanks so much for praying and take care, y'all. Be safe.
Let's pray together. Heavenly Father, it has been an unusual and a challenging week. Things change each day. We're trying to figure out what it means to practice social distancing and to understand what sheltering in place might be. Lord, would you give us courage? Would you still our anxieties and fears? Would you open our eyes to the needs that we can and should still meet as your followers? I pray for each person watching right now that you would remind them of your presence with them, that you would strengthen their faith, give them a sense of your supernatural peace. As your people who are your church, would you help us to know what it means to be your church when we can't gather together physically? Would you unite us? Would you unite us through your Holy Spirit and give us a vision for not just huddling in place, but in caring for the world that you love? Lord, we know that you hear our prayers, that you continue to hear our prayers, and we would pray together now, united in prayer around the prayer that our Lord taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. And now may the grace, the mercy, and peace of God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit be with you today and always. Amen. The hand sanitizer.
You're not going to use it?
Oh. I thought it'd be a funny tag. But you were frozen.
Oh, it's getting everywhere.
Good job, Zach.
Nice and clean.
Good. You left it wet. Now they're going to air dry. That's what you're supposed to do. Did you know that?
No.
You're not supposed to like rub it all the way in. You're supposed to get it on there wet and then just like
what?
Let the air dry. I don't know. It kills the germs more. Yeah. All right. Wave goodbye with your clean hands.